Chapter 22, Surrender of Johnston to Sherman, Capture of 50,000 Men. The closing act in General Sherman's superb career was his capture of the entire Confederate Army under Johnston. We give the account of it in his own words. On the 15th day of April, 1865, I was at Raleigh in command of three armies, the Army of the Ohio, the Army of the Cumberland, and the Army of the Tennessee. My enemy was General Joseph E. Johnston of the Confederate Army, who commanded 50,000 men. Retreating along the railroad from Raleigh to Hillsboro, Greensboro, Salisbury, and Charlotte, I commenced pursuit by crossing the curve of that road in the direction of Asheboro and Charlotte. After the head of my column had crossed the Cape Fear River at Avon's Ferry, I received a communication from General Johnston and answered it, copies of which I most promptly sent to the War Department, with a letter addressed to the Secretary of War as follows. Dated April the 15th, 1865, Headquarters Military Division of the Mississippi in the Field, Raleigh, North Carolina. General U.S. Grant and Secretary of War, I send copies of a correspondence to you with General Johnston, which I think will be followed by terms of capitulation. I will grant the same terms General Grant gave Lee, and be careful not to complicate any points of civil policy. If any cavalry has started toward me, caution them to be prepared to find our work done. It is now raining in torrents, and I shall await General Johnston's reply here, and will prepare to meet him in person at Chapel Hill. I have invited Governor Vance to return to Raleigh with the civil officers of his state. I have met ex-Governor Graham, Badger, Moore, Holden, and others, all of whom agree that the war is over and that the states of the South must resume their allegiance, subject to the Constitution and laws of Congress, and must submit to the national arms. This great fact once admitted, the details are of easy arrangement. W.T. Sherman, Major General. I met General Johnston in person at a house 5 miles from Durham Station under a flag of truce. After a few preliminary remarks, he said to me, since Lee had surrendered his army at Appomattox Courthouse, of which he had just been advised, he looked upon further opposition by him as the greatest possible of crimes, that he wanted to know whether I could make him any general concessions, anything by which he could maintain his hold and control of his army and prevent its scattering, anything to satisfy the great yearning of their people. If so, he thought he could arrange terms satisfactory to both parties. He wanted to embrace the condition and fate of all the armies of the Southern Confederacy to the Rio Grande, to make one job of it, as he termed it. I asked him what his powers were, whether he could command and control the fate of all the armies to the Rio Grande. He answered that he thought he could obtain the power, but he did not possess it at that moment. He did not know where Mr. Davis was, but he thought if I could give him the time, he could find Mr. Breckinridge, whose orders would be obeyed everywhere, and he could pledge to me his personal faith that whatever he undertook to do would be done. Can Johnston fill the contract? I had had frequent correspondence with the late President of the United States, with the Secretary of War, with General Halleck, and with General Grant, and the general impression left upon my mind was that if a settlement could be made consistent with the Constitution of the United States, the laws of Congress, and the proclamation of the President, they would not only be willing, but pleased, to terminate the war by one single stroke of the pen. I needed time to finish the railroad from the Neuse Bridge up to Raleigh, and thought I could put in 4 or 5 days of good time in making repairs to my road, even if I had to send propositions to Washington. I therefore consented to delay 24 hours, to enable General Johnston to procure what would satisfy me as to his authority and ability as a military man to do what he undertook to do. I therefore consented to meet him the next day, the 17th, at 12 noon, at the same place. We did meet again. After a general interchange of courtesies, he remarked that he was then prepared to satisfy me that he could fulfill the terms of our conversation of the day before. He then asked me what I was willing to do. I told him in the first place I could not deal with anybody except men recognized by us as belligerents, because no military man could go beyond that fact. The Attorney General has since so decided, and any man of common sense so understood it before. There was no difference upon that point as to the men and officers composing the Confederate armies. I told him that the President of the United States, by a published proclamation, had enabled every man in the Southern Confederate Army, of the rank of colonel and under, to procure and obtain amnesty by simply taking the oath of allegiance to the United States and agreeing to go to his home and live in peace. The terms of General Grant to General Lee extended the same principles to the officers of the rank of Brigadier General and upward, including the highest officer in the Confederate Army, that is, General Lee, the Commander-in-Chief. I was therefore willing to proceed with him upon the same principles. No white slaves. Then a conversation arose as to what form of government they were to have in the South. Were the states there to be dissevered, and were the people to be denied representation in Congress? Were the people there to be, in the common language of the people of the South, slaves to the people of the North? Of course, I said, no. We desire that you shall regain your position as citizens of the United States, free and equal to us in all respects, and with representation upon the condition of submission to the lawful authority of the United States as defined by the Constitution, the United States courts, and the authorities of the United States supported by those courts. He then remarked to me that General Breckinridge, a major general in the Confederate Army, was nearby, and if I had no objection, he would like to have him present. I called his attention to the fact that I had on the day before explained to him that any negotiations between us must be confined to belligerents. He replied that he understood that perfectly. But, he said, Breckinridge, whom you do not know, save by public rumor as Secretary of War, is in fact a major general. I give you my word for that. Have you any objection to his being present as a major general? I replied, I have no objection to any military officer you desire being present as a part of your personal staff. I myself had my own officers near me at call and was willing to grant what I claimed for myself. Breckinridge came a stranger to me, whom I had never spoken to in my life, and he joined in the conversation. While that conversation was going on, a courier arrived and handed to General Johnston a package of papers. He and Breckinridge sat down and looked over them for some time and put them away in their pockets. What they were, I know not, but one of them was a slip of paper written, as General Johnston told me, by Mr. Reagan, Postmaster General of the Southern Confederacy. They seemed to talk about it sotto voce and finally handed it to me. I glanced over it. It was preceded by a preamble and closed with a few general terms. I rejected it at once. Important conference. We then discussed matters, talked about slavery, talked about everything. There was a universal assent that slavery was as dead as anything could be, that it was one of the issues of the war long since determined, and even General Johnston laughed at the folly of the Confederate government in raising Negro soldiers, whereby they gave us all the points of the case. I told them that slavery had been treated by us as a dead institution, first by one class of men from the initiation of the war, and then from the date of the Emancipation Proclamation of President Lincoln, and finally by the assent of all parties. As to Reconstruction, I told them I did not know what the views of the administration were. Mr. Lincoln, up to that time, in letters and by telegrams to me, encouraged me by all the words which could be used in general terms to believe not only in his willingness, but in his desires, that I should make terms with civil authorities, governors, and legislators, even as far back as 1863. It then occurred to me that I might write off some general propositions, meaning little or meaning much, according to the construction of parties, what I would term glittering generalities, and send them to Washington, which I could do in 4 days. That would enable the new president to give me a clue as to his policy and the important juncture which then was upon us, for the war was over. The highest military authorities of the Southern Confederacy so confessed to me openly, unconcealedly, and repeatedly. I therefore drew up the memorandum, which has been published to the world, for the purpose of referring it to the proper executive authority of the United States and enabling him to define to me what I might promise, simply to cover the pride of the Southern men who thereby became subordinate to the laws of the United States, civil and military. Grim terms of war. I made no concessions to General Johnston's army or the troops under his direction and immediate control, and if any concessions were made in those general terms, they were made because I then believed, and now believe, they would have delivered into the hands of the United States the absolute control of every Confederate officer and soldier, all their muster rolls and all their arms. It would save us all the incidental expense resulting from the military occupation of that country by provost marshals, provost guards, military governors, and all the machinery by which alone military power can reach the people of a civilized country. It would have surrendered to us the armies of Dick Taylor and Kirby Smith, both of them capable of doing infinite mischief to us by exhausting the resources of the whole country upon which we were to depend for the future extinguishment of our debt, forced upon us by their wrongful and rebellious conduct. I never designed to shelter a human being from any liability incurred in consequence of past acts to the civil tribunals of our country, and I do not believe a fair and manly interpretation of my terms can so construe them, for the words, United States courts, United States authorities, limitations of executive power, occur in every paragraph. And if they seemingly yield terms better than the public would desire to be given to the Southern people, if studied closely and well, it will be found that there is an absolute submission on their part to the government of the United States, either through its executive, legislative, or judicial authorities. Every step in the program of these negotiations was reported punctually, clearly, and fully by the most rapid means of communication that I had. All the fruits of victory. And yet I neglected not one single precaution necessary to reap the full benefits of my position in case the government amended, altered, or absolutely annulled those terms. As those matters were necessarily mingled with the military history of the period, I would like at this point to submit to the committee my official report, which has been in the hands of the proper officer, Brigadier General Rawlings, Chief of the Staff of the Army of the United States, since about the 12th instant. It was made by me at Manchester, Virginia, after I had returned from Savannah, whither I went to open up the Savannah River and reap the fruits of my negotiations with General Johnston, and to give General Wilson's force in the interior a safe and sure base from which he could draw the necessary supply of clothing and food for his command. It was only after I had fulfilled all this that I learned, for the first time, through the public press, that my conduct had been animadverted upon, not only by the Secretary of War, but by General Halleck and the press of the country at large. I did feel hurt and annoyed that Mr. Stanton, coupled with the terms of my memorandum, confided to him a copy of a telegram to General Grant which he had never sent to me. He knew, on the contrary, that when he was at Savannah I had negotiations with civil parties there, for he was present in my room when those parties were conferring with me, and I wrote him a letter setting forth many points of it, in which I said I aimed to make a split in Jefferson Davis's dominions by segregating Georgia. Those were civil negotiations, and far from being discouraged from making them, I was encouraged by Secretary Stanton himself to make them. Righteous indignation. By coupling the note to General Grant with my memorandum, he gave the world fairly and clearly to infer that I was in possession of it. Now, I was not in possession of it, and I have no reason to know that Mr. Stanton knew I was not in possession of it. Next met me General Halleck's telegram, endorsed by Mr. Stanton, in which they publicly avowed an act of perfidy, namely, the violation of my truce, which I had a right to make, and which, by the laws of war and by the laws of Congress, is punishable by death and no other punishment. Next, they ordered an army to pursue my enemy, who was known to be surrendering to me, in the presence of General Grant himself, their superior officer. And finally, they sent orders to General Wilson and to General Thomas, my subordinates, acting under me on a plan of the most magnificent scale, admirably executed, to defeat my orders and to thwart the interests of the government of the United States. I did feel indignant. I do feel indignant. As to my honor, I can protect it. In my letter of the 15th of April, I used this language. I have invited Governor Vance to return to Raleigh with the civil officers of his state. I did so because President Lincoln had himself encouraged me to a similar course with the governor of Georgia when I was in Atlanta. And here was the opportunity which the Secretary of War should have taken to put me on my guard against making terms with civil authorities, if such were the settled policy of our government. Had President Lincoln lived, I know he would have sustained me. After the war, the foregoing narrative by General Sherman throws a clear light on his action, an action which was disapproved at Washington. He was anxious to stop the flow of blood and was willing to be magnanimous toward a fallen foe. Then followed the grand review of the troops in Washington, and on May 30th, Sherman took leave of his army in general orders. In the reorganization of the army, Grant became general and Sherman lieutenant general. When Grant became president, Sherman was elevated to the highest military office, which he retained until his retirement in February of 1884. Appropriately, we may close this part of our volume with Charles de Kay's striking poetical tribute to the brilliant commander, whose achievements went far toward saving the Union at the time of greatest peril. Rumble and grumble, ye drums, shrill be your throat, O pipes, writhe, blood-red flag, in your mourning hand. Serpent of harlequin stripes, but stars in the banners blue, smile for the war chief true, up from the myriad hearts of the land, comes, to your haven comes. Guns that sullenly boom, mourn for the master's hand, dreadful, uplifting the baton of war, while your hurricane shook the land. Marching, marching, battle and raid, gay and garrulous, unafraid, Sherman drove with his brilliant star, a dragon of eld, to its doom. Pass, O shade without stain, sunsets that grimly smile, shall paint how your signal flags deploy, battalions, mile on mile. Horsemen and footmen, rank on rank, sweeping against the foeman's flank, howling full of the strange mad joy of slaughter and fear to be slain.